Okay, I have the little time that I have. Let's go to the joy of belonging. Now, Now, if you read Matthew chapter 16 and verse 18, one very important statement made by Jesus is that he said he will build his church. Oftentimes, we have this notion that the church is being built by us. But yet, when we read the scripture, you find that Jesus said, I will build my church, which means that he has a personal interest in his church. And today, where is the church of Jesus Christ? The church of Jesus Christ sits right here. And so, we want to study a little bit and find out what is the meaning of the church. Now, the Greek term for the church is called ecclesia, used 114 times in the New Testament, but 90 times refers to the local church. So when people come and tell me that, you know, I don't have to be a member of the local church, then I look at my Bible and I say, I don't think I can agree with you. Because they say, I am part of the universal church of God, but I don't have to be accountable to any local church. I don't have to be responsible. I don't have to serve. I just be myself. Now, that kind of individualism comes from the world. It doesn't come from the church and from Jesus Christ. Now, the term ecclesia is simply means the called out ones. So, ek means out from or out to, and the root word is kaleo, is to call. So, it means that a group of people called out of the world to be witnesses for Christ. Though you are in the world, but you are not of the world, Jesus said. And therefore, you know that when you call yourself a Christian, you cannot adopt the principles of the world, and that you have to move to the principles of God's word. And so it is also known as an assembly or a congregation. In short, a church. Yeah? Wow, this is very sensitive. Okay. So let's look at the meaning ecclesia. Of course, number one, it means the universal body of Christ, where Jesus functioned as the Lord and the head of this universal body of Christ. So now you see that the head is in heaven, but the body here on earth. That's why in every location, the Lord has assigned a group of people to represent him as his body. And how he did that is that he gave them the Holy Spirit. That's why in every congregation, from Malaysia to Singapore to Indonesia to China, we have been to Bangladesh, we have been to India, we have been to Philippines, and all those places, you find that in every locality there would be an ecclesia combining to form the universal church of Christ. But yet each entity has its own government, each entity has its own leadership. So today, FaithLine here, you are the body of Christ. Now, anybody who needs healing, they will come here to touch you, because healing power must flow through you. And then those of you who need healing, then the body of Christ here will lay hands on you, and the healing power will flow to you. One thing I wrote on my Facebook is that God, he doesn't respond as much to needs. Because if he would have responded to needs, then everybody with a need would have their need met. But God responds to faith. What is faith? Faith means that you have to believe to receive. If you don't believe, you don't receive. So it's important for us to know that by faith, miracles happen. You saw the healing of those, actually there was another one whereby a man was deaf in his right ear, and when I commanded, that ear opened. And later on, he came to thank me, But he didn't have to thank me because I was just doing my job. I was just doing what the Lord wanted me to do. In every one of you, you have the power to heal. But yet, because some of you, you may not know it. Others may know it, but do not have the faith to do it. Because if you fail, you lose faith. When I was ministering to that first man, I saw them struggling, trying to heal him. The pastor was there trying to heal him. And so, normally, usually, I don't go down to do healing. But then the Holy Spirit told me and said, go and heal this man. I said, Lord, this man is mute. I knew that he is deaf and dumb since birth. If I can't heal him, I'm malu, you know, I lose face. So what should I do? I should stay safely on the stage and don't move and follow my principle of not healing anybody but allowing the church to do the healing. But the Holy Spirit said, go and heal him. And so I had to obey the Holy Spirit. But when I went there, I was like a little bit, okay, I need a lot of faith now. As I lay hands upon his ear, immediately his ear was open. So I asked him to repeat after me, and he said this. He did this. Ah, 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 ah. Means I can hear you, but I can't repeat because I'm dumb. All right? So now, what do? Then you say, sayonara, goodbye, since you are dumb. No, then I lay hands on his mouth and I commanded the spirit of dumbness to leave him. All right? I commanded and I said, you know, in the name of Jesus, this mouth be open. And that was when that video was shown when I said, say hallelujah. And he was able to form the word. And when the sound came out, everybody cheered, yeah? But that was what happened when you take the step of faith. My faith and your faith, they are the same. Okay? They are the same. It's just that you need to make your faith available. You just need to take that step of faith. Later on, there will be healing right here in the front. If those of you want to learn healing, you can come forward and learn healing. But you have to be a born-again Christian. You cannot be part-time Christian, part-time Buddhist. That one cannot work. All right? And then you also must have faith that God can use you. So, the universal body of Christ. Then you find that the Bible also refer often to the God's people in a given region. So, it says, then the church throughout all Judea, Galilee, and Samaria had peace. So that was the region that the ecclesia was mentioned. And then another one is now to the local church. And so there was a church in Corinth. And so when Paul wrote, he wrote to the church of God, which is at Corinth. So you find that ecclesia is being used in many ways. Now, being a member of a local church is most important. I know some people say, I don't want to be a member of any church. Why should I be the official member of any church? They say, show me in the Bible that says you have to be a member of the church. I will show you later that there is a word member. And so, but being a member of a church means that I identify with the people. Number one is I'm committed to this group of people. These are my brothers and sisters that God has given me so that together we can grow, together we can do the work of God. And so there is an interdependence, which means that when I need prayer, where do I first go to? I come to the church. I come to this group of people who pray for me. We have a prayer WhatsApp, all right? And there were many healing even through that WhatsApp, okay? I think Brother Jeff's father, right? receive healing through that WhatsApp. When we posted up, Brother Jeff's father was like, I think, dying already, right? Because he was in coma, his blood count was really low, and there wasn't any hope. Even when we went to hospital there to pray for him, to command healing, in my heart I was saying, wow, this is going to be tough, all right? But we kept on believing. Is your father here? Is your father here? He's not. Okay. The other day he came, yeah? So this is called interdependent. You need each other so that you will be able to pray for each other. And then you also be responsible to the kingdom of God. There are a lot of things that the Lord wants you to be responsible for. And also you are being accountable. That in a church body like this, you find that God has appointed leaders. And these are servant leaders who serve you. At the same time, they guide you. And so you become accountable to them. The purpose is that you grow spiritually, and then you have opportunities for ministry. The church itself creates platforms for ministry. Where's Pastor Carlson? Pastor Carlson, right at the back there. My spiritual son. I'm more handsome than him, I think. No. He's my, yeah. Okay. Because now he got young goat and all that, no? I asked him if he's trying to grow older than I am or what. I was desperately shaving and he's keeping all this, mountain man look, Yeah. But when he first came to us also, you find that he got a chance to grow spiritually. He got the opportunity to serve. And he got trained. And just on last Tuesday, he was invited to speak at the FGB. Actually, the full gospel businessman have asked him to preach a few times already, which means that he is now a well-accepted preacher. And also, he was preaching at the Beyond Borders, which is about 200, close to 300 young people from the region. They came to Malaysia, and Pastor Carlson was one of the preachers. Now, that is the kind of thing that we want to see all of you. If you can preach, I'm going to create one homiletics class. Homiletics means that preaching class, all right? Preaching class, so that you can attend. And I will be teaching and give you some guideline on how you can be a good preacher. So when I see young men like this growing up, and by the grace of God, and really by the grace of God, I pray that he will go out and plant a big church. Really plant a church that will win souls. We want every of our young people and even older people and those who come beyond the grave, all of them, to go and plant churches, all right? Not plant churches in the grave, huh? But go and plant churches. Yeah. Like, once you pass 60 and you say, But actually, last Friday, I asked my group, the Chinese group, and I asked them that if you have forgotten your age, what age would you be? I can tell you, everybody said very funny age, Some of them are like 60 plus, and then they say, oh, I'm in my early 40s, or I'm in my 30s. And then two sisters say, I'm 18. Wow. 18 years old, you are like a flower. Yes, even though the person may be 50 years old, but in the heart, in the spirit, you are always young. I more or less feel like I'm 35. I don't feel like 65. I don't know who added the 30 years, Somebody, sabotage me. I should look 35, Like this young chap here, Okay. All right. And then coming together, we can have kingdom achievement. Because one thing is that the devil wants to isolate us. Some of you think that you can just be grasshopper, hop from church to church, don't be a member of a church, and then you can grow spiritually and that you can find fulfillment in the kingdom of God. I tell you, that is not true. That is a lie of the devil. You have to stay put. When I was very young, they taught us in grammar school was that rolling stone gather no moss. And therefore, you keep rolling, rolling, rolling. You think that you are very, very happy jumping from church to church. Then one day you find that you start to have feelers. And then your face turns green. And you look in the mirror and you look like a grasshopper. All right? So be very careful. You might just transform. So the church first is a family. I want you to know that. Okay? Let's read the verse here. 1, 2, 3, go. Praise be to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realm with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Now you find that it says praise be to God, but it didn't end there. It tells you it's to our Father, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. So when we have Father, so Jesus would become like an elder brother to us, because we are joint heir with Him. And then the next verse says, let's read, for He chose us in Him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in His sight. Why? Because we belong to Him. He created us and then He chose us. Those of you who are sitting here, of course we tell you, you know that God chose you, and today you are here not by chance. God wants to maximize your life. Some of your life are so mundane that you feel that maybe it's better to go to heaven than just staying here. But if God give you breath and God still make you hungry every day, so you want to eat, which means that you are going to live on this earth, and God has an assignment for you. In life, the greatest pleasure is to know what God wants you to do and is to know what God wants you to be. So becoming is very important. And so then here it says, in love, let's read, in love, He predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with His pleasure and will to the praise of His glorious grace, which He has freely given in us in the one He loved. The emphasis here is that He had already pre-planned that you and I would become sons. Sons basically means also daughters, yeah? So that, and this sonship can only come through Jesus Christ and is in according not to our own desire, but to His pleasure and His will. And to the praise of His glorious grace. Why praise His glorious grace? Because grace saves us. It is not by your work. You look at yourself in the mirror. I know some of you are terribly righteous. You are like, when you were born, you were like innocent all your life. But yet there might be some areas in your life that may not be clean and unrighteous. And therefore you need Jesus. So we should say, the grace, now what happened to this grace? Which He has freely given to us in the one He loved, that is Jesus Christ. Pastor Ashok said it right. The whole focus is Jesus. Only Christ. I am here because of Christ. You are here because of Christ. We are one family because of Christ, not because of the organization or the planning and so on. Now, the Greek word for adoption to sonship, excuse me, adoption to sonship is a legal term referring to the full legal standing of an adopted male heir in the Roman culture, which means that though you have not been born into the kingdom and you have been adopted, but you have full rights as a son. And orphan does not adopt parents, but parents adopt the orphan. When the orphan is adopted, immediately becomes a son and a brother to other siblings. Therefore, when you enter the family, you do not sleep on the street anymore. I used to run an orphanage about 1,000 kids. When all the kids come into the orphanage, they do not sleep on the street anymore. None of my orphans slept on the street after they have been adopted into the orphanage. Of course, the orphanage at that time was not so much like a family. But I tried to be the father to them all. It's very tough to be a father to 1,000 children. But when I would enter we had five centers. So when I went to the center, you'll find that they call me Papa. They call me Papa. And I would sit on the floor. At that time, I could sit on the floor. I sat on the floor with them. And then, they were like crowding all over me. But if you notice one thing about our orphans is that they were very fat. Only in our orphanage, you find that all our orphans were well fed because I had a rule. They could eat as much as they wanted. Just because, you see, I watched that movie when I was very young called Oliver Twist. And that movie where that orphan was not allowed to eat. And that impression was very deep in my mind, in my heart. And when I started these orphanages, I set a rule that I will raise enough money for the children to eat. And therefore, when people came to our orphanages, they said, "Hey, we don't have to give you money. Your orphans are so fat. But you have to give us more money because we have to keep them fat." You see? So that's why the people continue to give us money. But what I'm trying to say here now is that when you are adopted into the family, behave like family. Some of you, you already saved. You are Christian, but you don't have a home church. You don't have a home church. Use the E-heart approach, right? E-H means everyone has a home. E-H-A-H. Okay? Everyone has a home. So if you are not under the E-heart system, means that you don't have a home, you don't have a home church, you don't have pastors over you, you are just the roaming samurai, you know, then you don't have, you are not part of the local body of Christ. You are just jumping from place to place. And so when orphans have been adopted, they have brothers and sisters. And the orphan is no longer an orphan. He has a family. The orphan surname is changed to that of the adoptive parents. The orphan becomes an heir to the parents' estate. So this is concept of adoption. So for us Christian, church membership is family. Is that we are all adopted in the God's family. Our surname is? Hello? Christian. We are Christian. Right? And we call ourselves, in this church, we call ourselves brother and sister. Some of you like to call name, which is fine. Huh? But when you see an older person, call him uncle. Huh? All right? You see but please, when you see an older woman, don't say auntie. Huh? Say sister. You say auntie, she might slap you. Yeah. For men, okay, you call us uncle, we are okay. But for ladies, you know, even they are like 70, 80 years old, I say sister. Okay? So we have siblings and we have family. Okay. The second thing is that the church is a fellowship. Now, God is faithful by whom you were called into the fellowship of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Everything begins with that foundation of Jesus Christ. If you have no fellowship with Jesus Christ, I can't call you brother, I can't call you sister. Excuse me. You know, in the world, we like to call ourselves bro, right? Everybody is bro. We go to mama's store, hey bro, right? I tell you, not everybody is your brother and sister. Because the one who is really your brother and sister is he got a fellowship with Christ. Excuse me. Oh, I need healing. Can someone heal me? Right. Let's read this one. One, two, three, go. And let us consider one another in order to... as in a manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. How do we consider one another if we were to stay at home in our pajamas and watching the sermon through YouTube? You see, it means that we have to gather. You see, let us consider one another to stir up love and good work, not forsaking the assembling, the gathering of ourselves together. Therefore, every Sunday, it is good for us to come to church. Wednesday, when there's prayer meeting, and there are other meetings, like Friday, we have Alpha. And all these meetings, we should find time to come. I know that some of you are working very hard. I'm a Singaporean, and therefore I know what this hard work is all about. But during those days when I was working and serving the church, I discovered one thing. Almost like every night I was at the church. Until my father said, "You think the house is a hotel?" Because we got so much things to do, and especially when the pastor appointed us to serve in various departments, and therefore we gave our very best. And so he said, "But exhorting one another so much the more as you see the day approaching." You find that this was written about 2,000 years ago. And so the day of the coming of the Lord is very, very soon. And he might just come immediately. So you got to be ready. Now, the word fellowship is the word called koinonia in the Greek. It means the Christian fellowship or body of believers. And in Merriam-Webster dictionary, it says intimate spiritual communion and participative sharing in a common religious commitment and spiritual community. So you find that in the secular world, they also understand what is koinonia. So, koinonia is not just any fellowship. Because what is the biggest danger is that when we say we have fellowship means what? We have food, right? Fellowship means must have food. And then fellowship, let's come for fellowship means we go bowling, or we go fishing, or we go for a tour. And recently is this durian trip. Wow, durian trip. Everybody, oh, praise the Lord, you know. Pastor, please pray for our durian trip. Huh? Pray for your durian trip. We are going to evangelize the durian farmers. Oh, okay. You want to evangelize the durian farmers. But koinonia is more than that. Koinonia is doing God's will together to fulfill the purpose of the kingdom of God. Therefore, coming together, having fun is good, but make sure that the bonding is for a purpose. The bonding is for the kingdom of God. Koinonia also means that, you know, our fellowship with our brothers and sisters is only as good as our fellowship with Christ. So it forms a cross, right? Means that your relationship got to be close to God. I can tell you, when I meet somebody who is very close to Jesus, and in my spirit, I would know immediately. I would know immediately. Because the person would not try to impress me, you know, because I'm the lead pastor of this church, so may they try to impress me that the person is very spiritual. Don't have to. The person just need to open up the mouth. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Just put that there. Just open up the mouth. Oh, thank you. Put that. I just want to tell you something. You know, the Bible says you give some water to the servant of God. He will go to heaven. Thank you. Guarantee. This one, guarantee, man. Thank you. All this obstacle, huh? All right, so our fellowship with our brothers and sisters is only as good as our relationship with Christ. And then what did Jesus do when he came here? When he was here, the only one thing he said, I must do the will of my Father. And then he wants us to be like him. Now, some of us here, we do have other secondary will. We do have things that we want to do. We want to do the will of our wives or do the will of our children and all that. You see, some people don't come to church because of children. I got a good friend whom I led to Christ. I tell you, it's a very sad case. And when I asked him, hey, I haven't seen you in church for so many months. And he said that, Albert, I tell you, I cannot come to church anymore. I say, why? He said, you see, Sunday is the only day I can bring my family shopping. And therefore, I don't think I can come to church because so limited time with my children and my wife. I can tell you now, the children most probably in their 40s already. But when they were growing up, they didn't have a chance to go to church because the father decided that, you know, I don't need the koinonia. I don't need the church, yeah? So the result, I think you know. Okay, so the definition of the koinonia, and this is the one that I thought through and I wrote it out, so you may not want to read it, but let's read it. Huh? The koinonia fellowship, let's read, the koinonia fellowship is a connection of the in-depth spiritual unity among believers that articulate itself in the external involvement with Christ and one another in accomplishing God's will for the kingdom of God on earth. One sentence, yeah? Yeah? But that, a lot of thinking through, because that is what it's all about. This kind of fellowship must go in depth. Means that when I sit down with you, I cannot be superficial. I have to engage you at the deeper level. I cannot ask you, sik pao me, and that's it. I have to ask you, how have you been growing in Christ? I have to ask you, how is your walk with the Lord? I have to find out your struggle. I have to find out what blocked you from becoming the person that God wants you to be. I know that everybody, God has a plan, but what stopped you from getting that plan fulfilled in your life? Therefore, when you talk to other pastors, they will sit down and talk to you. All right? They will spend time, long hours. And some of you like to tell stories, right? You're very good. You should be late, I saw, you know. So you are telling this long story. And we have to be very patient to listen. And sometimes you forget, you have already said that story a few times. Just like me, like that. I have preached something a few times and I forget, yeah? So the next thing I want you to know is that the church is a body. Now, this is where membership is mentioned. Because it says here, God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, what? Which is his body. All right? So very clearly, you are the body of Christ. The fullness of him who fills. Who fills everything in every way. So what is happening here? When people are looking for God, they can come to the church because the church is the receptacle. The church is the guardian of the presence of God. And therefore, if you are walking with God individually, make sure that your life is holy. For example, when you are outside in the world, when people are cursing and using vulgar language, do you join them? And do you tell them that you... somebody is singing, is it? Okay. All right. Yeah. It's okay. It's okay. We love children. Means that got future. Yeah. If I preach and there are many children interrupting, that's good. Sang toti la. Those of you are only two, you got eight more to go. Okay, so what we are saying to you is that the body of Christ, right, is where the power of God flows through, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. Okay, and then for just as the body is one and has many what? I found my word members. He said, Pastor, show me where we must be members of the body or members of the church. But you see, the Bible says that it's many members, or in your Bible, many parts, right? Because you are a part of the body of Christ. And all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. So here again, you see, the foundation is Christ, and then that we are His body. And then for in one spirit, now the Holy Spirit comes into the picture, because the Holy Spirit has taken you and baptizes you into the body. You were not a part of the body, but He, through miracle, now baptized you into the body, whether you are Jews or Greek or Chinese or Malay, Indian, whatever, all right, all were made to drink of one spirit. So He's telling you, no matter what race, you are going to be a part of the body. Understand, togetherness is very important. Some of us are so detached. You know why? Because that we say, oh, Pastor, I'm an introvert. Honestly, I tell you, personally, I'm an introvert too. I can stay at home and just focus on my sermon without seeing anybody for 1 week, and I don't feel lonely. Of course, I must see my wife, but I don't feel lonely. I need to go out and, you know, gallivanting, go out there and drink tea and all that. No, I have no need. But yet, because for the kingdom's sake, I learned to go out there and have tea with people. I learned to go out there and spend time with people, because I have much to share with them. So for the body does not consist of one member, but many. So if you say you are part of the church, remember, one sheep does not make a flock, because Jesus called you His flock. His flock means that you are part of a group of sheep, a flock of sheep. So if you are one sheep alone by yourself, you are not a part of the flock. A limb does not make a body. A member does not make a church. If you are just satu orang, you know, every morning you wake up, hi church, it's me. I'm the pastor, I'm the member, I'm the janitor, I am everybody. I'm going to preach to myself, amen. Now, then you have a problem. You need to come for prayer. Later you come here, I will personally lay hands on you. Yeah. So, the other thing is that now if the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I do not belong to the body, then the foot just get out and don't want to be part of the body. Imagine one day when you walk and your foot decided to be detached. They say, hey, where's my foot? Over there. Right? So, you do not expect your foot to behave like that, but yet you are behaving like that to the body of Christ. You are behaving as though, you know, some of the people like to say, you know, I am only attached to Jesus. Only Jesus. Don't worry about all these nonsensical people. I don't want to be part of them. Actually, every one of them, big hypocrite. Especially the senior pastor. Big hypocrite. So I don't want to come. So you want to be detached. And you are going to be, all right, you're going to be attached only to Jesus. So then you see Jesus with the head and one foot jumping around. And that's the body of Christ. And you think that is very, very exciting. No, that is a monster. One head and one foot. You know, the foot attached to the head. You are part of the body. All of us are together in this. All right? Then, and if the ear would say, because I'm not an eye, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. And so Paul was using this argument because there were people who were very self-focused, self-centered, and also highly intelligent, highly gifted. And when they are so highly gifted, they say, I can live on my own, all by myself, you know. I am all by myself, you know. Why? Because you are so intelligent. You earn a lot of money, you drive big cars, you have big houses, and then you can live by yourself. And some of you don't even want wife, you know. You just want many girlfriends. And that kind of a very hedonistic lifestyle is entering into the church, because you see what happened is that is the filtration, that is the impartation of the demonic world. And inevitably, because of your selfishness, you become a big receptacle for this kind of idea. And therefore, you live by yourself, you behave, and you don't want to mix with anybody because you just can't be bothered. I just live my own life. But yet, the Bible tells us that the church is there so that you can grow together. There are some people here you don't like, and there are some people here you like a lot. But because God gave you a gift, and a gift, remember I told you, is never for yourself except the gift of tongues. Other gifts are meant to bless others. This is the place where you bless others. Sometimes you see me after church, right? Haven't even got food, and I'll be sitting there trying to bless somebody. Why? Because you are important to me, right? My whole focus is what God gave me. This is the flock that God gave me. And I want to bless you. You don't want to bless me, it's fine. But my job is to bless you. And I hope that if you can imitate, like Paul said, imitate me as I imitate Christ, then I hope that you imitate me and start to bless others. There are many people who need your experience. Some of you, you got gray hair already, right? You got no hair already, right? But what happened is that you got a lot of experience. But you are going to say, I'm going to take my experience to the grave. Why you want to take your experience to the grave and be so selfish? Share with us. Share with us your experience. And so, if the whole body were to be an eye, imagine Pastor Charlie coming here, just one big eye. It's called Charlie Eye. Huh? Oh, ayo. Even the wife will get scared. Huh? Every night, see, one eye down there, just sleeping next to me. Right? The whole body with an eye. Where would the sense of hearing be? Right? Cannot hear the wife talking to him. If the whole body would be an ear, wow, that's lucky worse. Right? Where would the sense of smell be? You see the point here, that you need us and we need you. All of us need each other, and become the local church so that we can become the proper body of Christ. All right? Some of you can hear better, and that you are receiving word from the Lord. Some of you can speak better, then you are preaching the word of God. You are witnessing. Some of you have hands that can do. You are the hands that can do the work. Some of you, you are the feet that can travel the world, like just like we have gone to Indonesia. Did you know that during those 12 days, we did 12 services continually, non-stop. That's why these voices are gone, right? But you see the residue. You see the result of the ministry. Means that when we went there, what did we leave behind? What did the people, what take-home value did the people receive? I tell you what. Number one is that they learned how to heal in the name of Jesus. Immediately, you know that Pastor Echo, when he saw me doing that healing, immediately the next day in his own church, he healed people by himself. It gave him that faith. He saw it. He said, if this man can do it, I can do it. And we encourage it. In fact, the way that we do ministry is like that. We work ourselves out of a job, which means that we teach you how to do healing. We teach you how to preach. We teach you how to teach. Until such time that you have no need for us. All right? And we don't need to come back again. There were many churches never invite us back again. You know why? Because they could do it. And that is the whole thing. I don't need you to become dependent upon me. But release this gift and the people start to do the work. Then, of course, those people who have been healed, people who have arthritis knee for ages, you know, elderly ladies, people with back pain. Now, you might think that this is a very simple thing. But if you have back pain, how many of you ever got back pain? Raise your hand. You had, right? It wasn't nice, isn't it? It wasn't nice, isn't it? And I saw one lady, she was weeping away while people were trying to minister. You know why? Because she got an accident in the arm. And the arm no longer become mobile. Couldn't move because every time when she lifted up, she was in pain, in pain, in pain. And then I think in one of the video, In one of the video, she came up and she raised both hands and praising God. Let's give the Lord a big clap offering. Praise God. I tell you. Because that lady, I was there and I watched her. And the others were trying to heal her. And I saw the pain, the anguish. And I heard her prayer. I heard her prayer. And she's crying out to God, Tuhan, you know, please heal me. And in her own language, and weeping tears. And in my heart, I say, God, you got to heal her. You got to heal her. She crying out like that. And then the next thing I realized was that she was up on stage, raising both hands. You see? Give the Lord another clap of offering. Praise God. I tell you, I get excited. You know, I've been doing healing for 14 years. But every time somebody got healed, I still get excited. I don't know about you. Maybe you say. But for me, like, ooh. Because I knew, and I know, I'm not the one doing it. I just happen to be the channel. All right? So would you be the channel? Would you be the channel? All right? Would you be the channel and let the power of God flow? And the best part is this. When I was, Pastor William laid hands on me. I got this back pain. 10 years, right? Lay hands on me. The pain left a little bit, like 20%. But 80% of the time, I was still in pain. But the Lord said that, I want you to heal others. So for 2 years, whomever I lay hands got healed. But I wasn't healed. One day, one man came with the same problem. I lay hands on him. He was healed. The pain left him, but no more back pain. So I said, God, not fair. You heal him, you never heal me. Right? And God said, would you do healing if you're not healed? I said, yes. Of course. No question about it. I didn't even have to think about it. Because that's my call. Whether I'm healed or not, beside the point. If I'm called to be a doctor, I'll be the best doctor. If I'm called to be someone who has the power to heal, I will do my very best. Alright? Then 2 years later, one day I got up completely healed. Nobody touched me. Nobody laid hands on me. Only God Himself laid hands on me. Give the Lord a big clap offering. Because I want you, those of you who are sick, and then you say, Lord, you heal me first, then I do lah. Huh? Lord, you save my family first, then I go and preach the gospel lah. If you don't save my whole family, I will not preach to a single person. That's, you are very selfish. Then no wonder nobody in your family got saved, and no wonder you are not healed. But because the idea here is this way. When you open your hand, God will open His hand. You open your hand, He opened His hand. You bless, He bless. It's always like that. And you plant the seed, He give you the harvest. You don't plant the seed. A hand, right? A hand without any seed, there'll be no harvest. Right? Empty hand will not do anything. That's why later on, when I say come forward and learn healing, you learn. You come and learn from the brethren who they all have been trained. But you must be willing. You cannot be, you know, I'm malu lah. But when you chase girl, you're not malu. This one, you're malu. Oh, okay. Let me go on. Okay. And now had God set the members, each one of them, in the body, even as it pleased Him. And if they were all one member, where were the body? But now they are many members, but one body. So remember, we are many members, but one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. The head cannot say to the feet, I don't need you. And on the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. Therefore, you find... there was one time when I kicked... by the side of the table, I kicked on the leg of the table, and the little toe got swollen. How many of you had that? You had that, right? Wow! I tell you, that little toe become the most important thing throughout the whole week, right? Every time when you bathe, you must look at the little toe. When you walk, you must look at the little toe. When you wear your shoe, you must look at your little toe. Anything you want to do, you look at your little swollen toe, right? That little feeble members. How many of you say, oh, I hit my little toe. Wife, take a knife and cut it off. Why? You think you are the yakuza or whatever. Cut off the pinky and cut off the toe. No, You see, he said that they seem to be weaker are indispensable, and the parts that we think are less honorable, we treat with special honor. Okay, very quickly. And parts of the members that are unpresentable are treated with special modesty, while our presentable part need no special treatment. Therefore, certain part in our body we cover up, isn't it? We wear clothes. All right? They are not presentable, but we treat them with modesty. And so, but God has put the body together, giving greater honor to the members that lack it, so that there should be no division in the body, but its members should have equal concern for each other. Therefore, you find that the people who serve as usher, the people who are now at the back doing the media, they are the one who is in charge of all the slides. And you don't see them. They're always in darkness, not because they are living in darkness, but because they are serving God, right? And then you find people like us who are in the limelight. And so you are looking and say, wow, these are the more important people. But you're not. Look behind you. Brother Adrian C is managing the camera. Just turn around and see that young man there. Give him a hand, yeah? He is very important. If not, this will not be on the YouTube. You see the point here? He got to do that job. And there's a camera here. Nobody is managing it, yeah? Okay. So if one member suffer, every member suffer with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it, or every member rejoices with it. And now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. So you understand now that why together we can participate with your struggle, and we can also give you comfort, and you can give us comfort too. Don't just say, I want to be the recipient, but I don't want to be the giver. But you have to be the donor, you have to be the giver. All right? And God has placed in the church first of all apostles, second prophet, third teachers, then miracles, then gift of healing, of helping, of guidance, and of different kinds of tongues. All these gifts are given to the body of Christ. That some of you, you may not be able to preach, but you have the gift of help. Some of you are able to, just by being there, and your presence would provide such great comfort to the person who is struggling. All right? I have seen that during lunchtime, some of you are amazing. And the way you all share, the kind of in-depth bonding that you have created. And so, are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, do all work miracles, do all have gift of healing, do all speak in tongues, do all interpret, now eagerly desire the greater gift. What Paul was saying is that gift that you don't have, you can find it here. The thing that you need is found in the person next to you. Some of you, you need advice, you find that the person sitting next to you can give you advice. And she is your wife. So chances are that you need to ask. But I'm telling you, in the church, there are many, many people with different gifts. Okay? Like now, our church needs people to do accounting. And then we are also getting ready for a new worship team. How many of you are musically inclined? Raise your hand. Raise your hand. Only one person, two person. Means at least you know how to play the keyboard or the guitar. How many know how to play guitar? Oh, you know how to play guitar. How many know how to play keyboard? None. Okay. All like not gifted one this church. Okay, how many of you know how to play CD player? Okay, praise God. All right. Okay, the final point here. The church is an army. Very quickly. Church membership is enlisted soldiers. The very moment you sign up, you become a soldier. Here is what Paul told Timothy. He said, join with me in suffering like a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No one serving as a soldier gets entangled in civilian affair, but rather tries to please his commanding officer. You become a soldier in the army of God. And then he says, Timothy, my son, I'm giving you this command in keeping with the prophecy. You see, he's giving him a command. So here, Paul, not just acting like a father, he's acting like a commander, all right, sent by God, a leader. Okay, I'm giving you this command in keeping with the prophecy once made about you, so that by recalling them, you may fight the battle well. There are prophetic gifts, there are prophetic words that's been given to you. The Lord told me, never give up. The Lord told me, whatever happened to your life, you have made a lot of mistakes, but do not give up, because my Holy Spirit is going to work through you, that even in your old age, you are going to be more powerful than when you were young. And I believe that, because that word came through a prophet. It was in America when he walked down and he prophesied over me. And while I was so shocked, I was like, whoa, what's going on? And good thing they recorded it. And so I transcribed it. And from time to time, I read it and say, wow, what happened? And true enough, it was like when I was 61 years old, then you see, FaithLine got started. Then I can tell you, this church is going to grow. This church is going to be powerful. And this church will fight the devil. Give a Lord a big clap offering. Amen. Amen. All right. We are going to fight the battle well, but we are going to be soldiers. Yeah. And then though we live in the world, what it says, we do not wage war as the world does, which means that there is a higher level of battle going on. There's a spiritual battle that your flesh cannot fight. Some of you are boxers. Some of you are martial artists, but all those are useless in the spiritual arena. I can tell you, you need spiritual power. You need spiritual firepower. And spiritual firepower can only come when the church gathers together. When you are alone, you will be assassinated. You will be killed. All right? They always separate the person and kill him. But when you are together, you find the power is immense. The weapons that we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power. Look, God has given us weapon with divine power. Say, I have weapon with divine power. Say it again. I have weapon with divine power. Give a Lord a clap offering. Praise God. Receive it. Receive it. I don't care whether you are 6 years old or you are 65 like me, but you have the weapon that has divine power to demolish strongholds. You see, every one of you. But some of you say, oh, but Pastor, I got a lot of strongholds in myself. Then get rid of those. Get rid of those. Repent. First, number one, write down, repent. Repent of those sins. You got this pet sin. Nobody knows. This secret sin. Nobody knows. All right. You got this hatred. You got this gossip. You got this thing that's in your heart. You hate somebody for 30 years. All this, get rid of it. Surrender to Jesus. Then number two, renounce. Renounce means tell the devil, get lost. You have no more control over my life. Yes, I know you use that sin to control me. Oh, that sexual sin, or that sin of lie, or whatever. Deception. You use that to control me. But now, because I confess to Jesus, I ask Him to forgive me, I now renounce you. Get lost. So, repentance is towards God. Renunciation is towards the devil. Get lost. And then what you do is refill. The third one is refill. Fill with the Holy Spirit. Fill with the Holy Spirit. And always stay with the Holy Spirit. Don't let go. Now, somebody asked me, Pastor, how do you stay in the anointing and keep staying in the anointing? When tonight or today that you have the anointing of the Holy Spirit, you hear the word of God, you get charged up. You know what? You know how to stay in? Just don't get out. That's all. Don't get out. Means go. Wherever you go, even when you eat, there's anointing. All right? And when you talk, different already because you have the anointing. Don't get out. Don't suddenly change mask. You know, you go outside, you become a monster. Become a grasshopper. No, stay. Stay in the present, because Jesus said, lo, I'm with you always. He guaranteed He'll be with you always. All right, I've got to go very quickly. So, It says we demolish arguments and every pretense that set itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient. I told you the battle is higher. The battle is not in the physical. The battle is in the spiritual. There are spiritual schemes. There are spiritual plans against you. Some of you are very sick. And the Lord is telling you, your sickness is connected to your sin. But, Pastor, I know sin. You know sin. Maybe that's your sin. Because you say you know sin. If you cannot identify your sin, you have a problem. Because some of us here, what is our sin? Bitterness. Bitter roots. Bitter roots. Bitter roots come out, bitter fruits. And I've got pain here. I told you the story of this auntie, right? 4 months. Back pain. Cry, back pain. Ask the pastor to heal back pain. Until we went there, all we ask is that, repent. Forgive the person you hate. And she repented. She cried and said, forgive me. The very moment she said, amen, boom, all the pain gone. How come? I tell you, you give the devil the legal rights to hold you. You love the devil so much, so he's holding you. Whole song, so shook. This pain, 20 years already, very shook. Some people don't want to be healed. They love the pain. Because why? They know the way. They know this button to press, but they don't want to press. They want to go here and do this. But this one, ping, they're healed. They don't want. Why? Too proud. When you come to God, remember, repent, renounce, refuse. Your life will be always powerful. Okay? And all this demonic scheme against you will be destroyed. And so, we are to stand for the truth. We are to tear down the stronghold of lies and deceit in your life. We are to destroy every scheme of the enemy. I don't want this scheme of the enemy to attack you and your children. Some of your children are coming under the attack of the same scheme. Because of your selfishness, because of your stubbornness, you know what's going on? It's showing in your children. Then you look at your children, wow, exactly like me. Wow. As stubborn as I am. Wow. Their lies also. Just like me. Wow. Just like me. Right? What happened? Because you are allowing the devil an access into your life. Don't give him legal rights. The only legal rights that you can give to is to Jesus. Because Jesus paid your price. And activate that. And say, by your blood. I'm covered by your blood. And nothing will harm me. And then you are being set free. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gate of Hades or the gate of hell shall not prevail against it. This is the last slide. And this is what I want to tell you. The gates of hell are not a weapon. The gates of hell are a defensive, protective element. All right? But how come here Jesus say, the gate of hell shall not prevail against the church? Because the church is not in the fortress. The church is outside of the fortress, and the church is attacking. Because we are attacking. You know how many people got delivered from demons? Because we are attacking. Okay? In Aitawa, when we went there, one man, 40 over years old, he was under, you know what's Kong Tao or not? You know what's Kong Tao? It's witchcraft. He was under Kong Tao, witchcraft. There was a Vietnamese girl, only like 19 years old, used a witchcraft against him and took all his money and left him. And he was left without money, and the girl did not lift off the witchcraft off him. And so for a few years, he was like, in the days because of witchcraft. The church didn't know how to handle that. The church thought that he went crazy. His friend brought him to us, Pastor Grace and I. Immediately we cast out that demon. He was set free. Immediately he became alert. Give the Lord a clap offering. I want you to praise God. You have power. You understand? You have great power. You can come against the devil, but you got to get right with God. Remember, the fellowship with Jesus Christ is power. And then you start to do the work of the Lord. Therefore, Jesus said, the church that he built, only the church that he built, not any churches, the church that he built, all right? The gate of hell shall not prevail against it, because we shall invade. We shall invade hell and take soul and populate heaven. Can you do this? Huh? Can you do this? Huh? You see? You see? This is what you do. All right? Give a lot of clap offering. Praise God. I want you to bow your heads and close your eyes in prayer. Because God is good. Later on, you know, when you go outside, maybe you get a form and just fill in. If you feel that God has sent you to this church so that you can work here, so you can use your talent here, so you can do your warfare against the devil. As your eyes close and your head bowed with the Lord, I'm going to pray for you. But how many of you would say, Lord Jesus, today I really want to commit every part of my life, Lord. There might be areas that I have failed you, but I know that if I humble myself, you will forgive me and you will fill me with your Holy Spirit and you will empower me again and again. Lord, I need the refilling of the Holy Spirit. I need the reassurance of the vision in my life. I need to walk again, Lord, on the path of success, on the path of victory, on the path whereby you are walking. And I really want to be your follower. I want to be your disciple. And most importantly, Lord, let the Holy Spirit use me mightily, that my life will not be wasted. If that's your prayer, can you raise your hand to God? And I'm going to pray with you. Yes. Yes, all over. Praise God. Yes, just raise your hand to God. Humble yourself. Yes. Amen. 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 Praise God. Yes. Hallelujah.